Okay, welcome learners. Today I would like us to look at the cause statement. So I want us to start with the definition. Definition of cost. And cost statement. So, a cost, you can say it is the value of economic resource. It is the value of economic resource expressed in financial terms. The value of economic resource expressed in financial terms. So, any commodity, in order for you to know the cost of that commodity or service, you must come up with a cost. So, any economic value, of a resource. A resource can be either a good, it can be either goods or services. Okay, so I would like us to look at the definition of cost statement. Now, cost statement, this is a presentation. It's a presentation of cost data in form of a statement. It is a presentation of cost data. The information about cost, you present it in a form of a statement. That is a cost statement. Now, before we look at the format of the cost statement, I would like us to look at the elements of cost. Remember, in costing, we say most organizations, they cost their products according to how much they used to produce the commodity. That's the production cost. So, for you to get the production cost or the total cost of production, you must understand the elements of cost. We have three main elements of cost. So, number one, we have raw materials. Number two, we have labor. Then we have number three, overheads. Let us start with the raw materials. So when we say raw material, this is the main element of cost, whereby we get the material cost. The amount which you spend when you are buying the inputs, which you are going to use or to manufacture to output. So the raw materials are the inputs which are used in manufacturing companies to come up with the output. So in most cases, raw materials, they are supposed to consist 50% to 70% of total cost. They consist of 50% to 70% of total cost. Because it is the main element of cost, raw materials are supposed to be more than the other elements. So you must have the minimum of 50% and a maximum of 70%. So for you to control the raw materials, you must have a system of controlling the raw materials. In most cases, in the production department, they have the stores department whereby they record the raw materials. They record the raw materials when they receive. They record when they receive, which we call receipts. When they issue the materials, they record, which we call issues. Then they get the balance. Now, for you to control the raw materials, you must make sure you record the receipts, you record the issues, and you record the balance. When you are recording these materials, we have a book which we call Stores Ledger. So the stores accountant has to prepare a stores ledger to record the materials they receive, the materials they issue, and the ones which remain in the store. So in this stores ledger, you must have, let me show you the format so that you can understand. You must write the raw material which you are purchasing. So you have the columns which you indicate. First, the date, you indicate the receipts, you indicate the issues, and you indicate the balance. Now, the date, you have to indicate the year, the month, and the day. Then we have the quantity which you receive, you indicate in the first column the receipts, you indicate the price, that is the rate. Then you indicate the amount. The same case, the issues. Indicate the quantity. The rate, that's the price. And the amount. The same case with the balance. You indicate the quantity, the rate, and the amount. Rate stands for the price or the cost. So the costing department in the manufacturing company must come up with the stores ledger card in order to control the levels. So for you to prepare this ledger, you must understand the levels of stock. You must understand the levels of stock. The level of stock, we have the maximum level of stock, and we have minimum stock level. We have the order level, and we have average stock level. Okay, when we say maximum stock level, we mean the level is the level beyond which the stock should not allowed, should not be allowed to fall. Should not be allowed. Should not be allowed to rise and fall. The stock level in which if you have materials, you should not continue purchasing. You should not allow that stock level to rise. So in this case, the purchasing department should not make orders, should not receive materials. Then the minimum is the level, it is the level below which stock should not be allowed to fall. Should not be allowed to fall. If you reach this minimum stock level, you should not issue. You stop issuing the materials, then you start now receiving. Instead of issuing, you receive. Then we have the reorder level. This is a level whereby the purchasing department issues or gives out the purchasing order. The purchasing orders are given to suppliers to start now supplying extra or more goods. So when you reach the reorder level, it is better to give out the purchasing orders for the suppliers to continue issuing or bringing the materials to the company. Now the average stock level is the average between maximum, so it is the average of maximum stock level and a minimum stock level. So we can get the average stock level by dividing maximum and the minimum. By dividing maximum and the minimum by 2. So we have maximum stock level plus minimum stock level over 2. That's how we get the average stock level. So I would like us to continue with the second element, which is labor. Labor, this is the human effort. This is a human effort. Now in labor, we look at the wages. How are you going to give out the wages? So you must understand the terms of employment which you have agreed with the employees so that you can know how to calculate wages. So wages are supposed to be calculated accurately. You calculate wages accurately. Next one, the workers are paid in time and they are paid at the rate, their agreed rate. So in calculating wages, we have 3 methods. We use time rate. We can use piece rate. And we can use the others, which we call for the incentives. So you can use time rate, whereby you multiply the number of hours worked by each employee by the wage rate which you agree. Piece rate, you count the pieces or articles which have been produced. Then you multiply by the piece rate, agreed piece rate. Others, like now, the incentives, we have the bonuses. We have the bonuses, we have the commission. The bonus, we have the premium schemes, whereby they decide which scheme they are going to use to calculate the wages so that they can pay those employees who are on a permanent basis, who does not receive overtime. Those overtime is another incentive. And the overtime is given to those people who does not receive bonuses. Any work which you do extra hours, you receive overtime. Bonus we give to permanent employees who do not receive overtime or commission. Commission is for agents. They are given a percentage from their sales. So make sure you know how to control wages. I thought about the wages in the labor costing. We learned about how we can create the wages and how we prepare the payroll. I want to look at the overheads. That's where we are going to take more time. The overheads. Also, these are the expenses which are incurred in the production of goods. These are expenses incurred mostly in manufacturing companies to produce goods. They are very important because no production will continue without incurring such expenses. These expenses or overheads are classified. They are classified into, we have production overheads. We have administration. Overheads. We have selling and distribution. Selling and distribution overheads. Under this classification, we call it classification by function. So when we say production overheads, these are the overheads which are incurred when converting raw materials to finished goods. So in the production department. So for these production overheads, examples may include, we have factory rent, we have power, we have lighting and heating. They are incurred in the production department. We have salaries to the supervisors. And also we have depreciation for brand or machine. These are the expenses which are incurred in the production department. Then we have administration. Administration expenses, we call them also office expenses. Any expense which is incurred in the office while you are preparing records. You can have office rent, office salaries, wages. You have depreciation for office machine. We have rates. We have water and electricity. There are so many, the normal expenses, all the normal expenses, we transfer them under administration. We have postage. We have printing, stationery, printers, there are so many. All of them which are required in the office, we classify them into administration or office expenses. Then we have selling and distribution. Selling and distribution overheads. These are the expenses incurred when taking the products from the company, the market. So when you want to make sure that the product reaches the consumer or the final customer. So those expenses which you incur, we classify them under selling and distribution overheads. So they include, we have salesmen salaries, we have depreciation for the delivery van, or you can say the delivery van expenses. We have advertisement. All those, also any activity or service which you can offer to the customers. So next time I want to look at the cost statement format.